As now is Aksyon Klima Pilipinas convener Rodney Galicia. Rodney, good morning. Welcome to the program.
Hi, good morning. Good morning to everyone. And we hope that everyone is safe after the onslaught of Typhoon Karding.
Mm-hmm. Indeed. Rodney, one peculiar aspect of Typhoon Karding is that it quickly intensified into a super typhoon in a matter of hours. The public has just been introduced to the concept of rapid intensification. And no less than the president said, we have never seen this before. So let me ask you the same question he asked. Yan na ba yung climate change?
There are so many factors affecting the typhoons, no? And we've seen this in Typhoon Yolanda before because of the intensified heat and in the Pacific Ocean. We know that almost 94% of the heat is being absorbed by the ocean, and such actually affects processes when it comes to the intensification of typhoons. As we all know, the Philippines, we have 20 to 25 typhoons per year, but before we got the signal number 1, 2, and 3. And after that, for the last 10, 15 years, now we developed not only signal number 4, but signal number 5. So that means that because of the inconsistencies in climate patterns, intensities of typhoons are getting higher and higher. And we never see this before. But saying that this only happened like during Typhoon Karding, no, it did not. In the last how many years, we've seen already intensification of typhoons.
Mm-hmm. And Rodney, that many people have to ask this question, it's not just the president, to be fair. Is that an indication of the level of awareness of the public of the effects of climate change? A UN climate change report last year already warned that global warming is dangerously close to spiraling out of control. So how do we explain this to the public to make it simple, easy to understand, and make it relevant to their daily lives?
Yes. In simple terms. Filipinos, the emission, carbon emission of Filipinos is very, very small. Almost 0.4% of the total. And the losses and damages that we experience, specifically for Typhoon Yolanda, that will explain how serious this issue is. But at the same time, it is at the level of demanding from larger countries who are responsible to larger emissions, and so who are responsible to, you know, their biggest industrialization since, of course, the Industrial Revolution have actually affected a lot of patterns and natural processes. And not only that, when we talk about the climate crisis, it's not only about emissions, not only about actually intensification of climate typhoons, is also how we see development, because there are so many development strategies, not only of the government, not only of the Philippines, but the whole world, that will intensify also the effects of the climate crisis. So at the end of the day, this should actually be discussed by nations at the United Nations, because recently it is so difficult to put losses and damages issues and cases in the following conference of parties, specifically in Egypt, because the larger countries would see that as a burden for them. But for us, it must be demanded not only the historical losses and damages, calculate it, the value of it, but only the present and the future.
Mm-hmm. Now, the president did mention that climate change in his UNGA speech, but how do you reconcile his question yesterday asking if this is climate change? Was that really an honest question because he genuinely wanted to know if that was the effect of climate change, or was he merely making a point to the public? Given that, of course, in that UN General Assembly speech, climate change was a big part of that speech.
I think when we look at the narrative, so many times during his oath taking and even during the SONA, you know, State of the Nation address, and the United Nations General Assembly statement, I believe the president is just only making a point that this is happening. And this is, but you know, less than a month, we experienced 3 super typhoons, the intensification of it. And then at the same time, as you've said, in just an hour, it intensified to super typhoon signal number 5. So I believe the president is making a point, and we hope that with his words at the United Nations General Assembly, he will take it seriously. And even if he wishes to go to the Conference of Parties in Egypt, that would be, of course, will be happy. And so he will be able to make a point, not only for the Philippines, but also for other countries who are most vulnerable to the climate crisis.
And talk about that UNJ speech. The president said climate change is the greatest threat affecting various nations. He also touched on historical injustice, how those who are least responsible, like the Philippines, suffer more. Were you encouraged that the president specifically mentioned that in his speech?
Yes, of course. And we've been fighting for climate justice. And for us, climate justice is actually making singil, no, of the historical debt of other nations. And as we all know, more than 10,000 lives and lives and livelihoods have been lost, and we cannot afford any more losses and damages. And though we are not responsible for those greater emissions, these countries are responsible, and we make them accountable. And through loss and damage mechanism, you know, we call this WASI international mechanism, we'll be able to actually make them accountable. And of course, influence them, force them if necessary, in diplomatic terms, no, to actually sit down with us, and instead of us asking for loans, we need to have more grants, and through diplomacy and through, you know, demanding climate justice, then we can actually make something out of these loss and damage mechanism towards sustainable financing for our adaptation and mitigation strategies, specifically for the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. Rodney, you talk about that mechanism to assess possible liability, but how feasible is that to actually implement that system? And how can we accurately tell or accurately measure or quantify the impact of climate change in a particular country?
There is a working group already, and that's in the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. This group, this working group, is the JAGWA network now for loss and damages, are tasked to think, no, and to sit down on how the mechanism would be implemented. But I think when we talk about the Philippines, declaring climate emergency would be a big help, not only for LGUs, but the national level, institutionalize it as a law. Because at the end of the day, if we have that institutionalization of climate emergency, and that includes actually loss and damages, the national determined contribution, then we have that document, no? And even actually asking other nations to do so. So if that will be part of the law of the land, then we can lobby. At the level of the United Nations that indeed liabilities and help, financial assistance would be, of course, be given to countries like the Philippines. It's a long dialogue, no? And even at the level of deciding whether to put that on the agenda, in the agenda, we need more people. And actually, the civil society organizations for quite so long have been helping the government to talk to other nations, to talk to our counterparts in other countries, for them also to influence their own governments to, you know, to decide on these important matters. And we hope that the national non-government organizations and other sectors will be included in the series of consultations, and the Climate Change Commission has been very, very open for the last 3-4 months for the civil society and even other sectors to sit down together on how to strategize to, you know, to influence the platform, United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, and even the presidency in Egypt for COP27, you know, to put that in the agenda.
Mm-hmm. Before we talk about the declaration of climate emergency, let me go back to that suggestion of coming up with a law that will impose compensation for loss and damage due to climate change. How can we enforce that on other countries, Rodney? Have you seen any way that this has been, or any previous incident that this has been effectively enforced, a country forced to pay for the damage to another country due to climate change?
Recently, we have Denmark already, Denmark already committing to do some kind of financing and assistance to countries affected by the climate crisis, specifically those who have experienced losses and damages. We know also that Scotland, before during COP26, has already committed to help. As I have said, it will be actually not really a difficult process, but it's a matter of persuasion. It's also a matter of sitting down together, not only in the halls of COP27, but also in the sidelines, because as we always say, real negotiations happen during coffee breaks, happen during dinners and during meals. We hope that with the help of not only of the government, but other sectors, we'll be able to convince bigger countries to do so.
Lastly, and very quickly, how will the declaration of climate emergency help all these?
The Declaration of Climate Emergency will actually give a roadmap and even policy track or policy reform when it comes to development. The Congress has already approved the General Appropriations Act, but having a climate emergency law, which will also amend the Climate Change Act of 2009 as amended with the People's Survival Fund. This will have a bigger influence on our development track, on our investment plans, among others, to be serious enough and be required, tag and even propose projects, programs, and activities that are climate screen, meaning to say, if we see that the climate crisis is a real threat, then it can be a policy track influence, all our strategies and even the Philippine Development Plan. So,
all right.
The DAA has some provisions actually, but it is only effective for a year. But if we have a law which will be a basis for policy reform, then and enabling laws and resolutions, then it should be necessary. We can also bring that to the United Nations as well.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning, Rodney Galicia, convener of Aksyon Klima.
Thank you, Mike.